is 10 o'clock, so we're going to start as people enter. My name is Dr. Joyce Bluford. Kids call me Dr. Joyce. I'm especially like this subject because the kind of scientist I am is a geologist. It's somebody who studies the Earth. And so we're going to take a look at how our Earth looks like today and figure out how it got that way. We're going to look at glaciers. We're going to look at sandstone, sandstorms and wind and rain and gravity. And we're going to see why our Earth looks the way it does. Now, with me is Debbie Davidson. She's going to monitor you guys, make sure nobody gets out of hand. Now, remember, the rules are we have you muted. Only at the end, we have about 10 minutes of questions, and then you will raise your hand digitally, and then we'll call on you, and you could ask questions. Also, there's like a homework assignment, or depending on how your teacher wants you to do it, you'll be getting some worksheets, and so you need to listen, minds on, as we go on our journey around the Earth to look at landscapes. So notice I use the word landscape. That means kind of what it looks like. And then I sometimes use the word landform. And a landform is specific types of forms. So on here, if you look at this picture, this model here, this, if you're in a plane, you'd look down. And this is a volcano. And if you look at it on the side, you'll see that it goes inside of the Earth. So we'll be looking at the surface of the Earth and figuring out how it occurred. Remember, all of these kind of maps and globes, they're kind of flat. It doesn't show you the relief when you walk around, you see hills and valleys. So let's continue on our journey. Now, landscapes changes because of erosion. Now, erosion. What does that mean? That means as our Earth is like almost a scape, like an artist or a sculptor is making our landforms be mountains and valleys. Now we're going to figure out how that erosion occurs. Now this is another picture of a map. Maps are great because they locate you and it's always good to know where you are. But if you look at this map, you'll notice that in the upper parts, so the upper parts of this globe here, you have what would affect it? Is it warm? Is it cold? It's cold. Is there ice? Yes, there's ice. And so up here, we will look at the different types of erosion caused by ice. But most of our Earth is what? Is it land or is it water? It's mainly water. So there's an awful lot of water erosion. Also, water does something really unique. It can evaporate and precipitate and go into what we call the water cycle. And this water cycle does a lot of erosion, especially in hurricanes. We will see that on the coastal areas, the waves can hit the land and cause erosion. We'll also look at areas where there's wind erosion, and that would be places like Africa in the deserts. Even in California, we have some really big deserts. We will see what kind of effect it does over time. So first of all, I want to make sure you understand what landforms or landscapes we have here in the San Francisco Bay Area. We will look at a hill or a little bump. We'll look at a mountain like Mission Peak. We'll look at a valley like the whole bay itself is down. It's filled with water, but that's a valley. We will look at a bay like the San Francisco Bay. We'll look at a peninsula, land that's surrounded by water on three sides. And we'll look at a plain, which is flat. So let's take a look at a map. Now, Phoebe's going to explain what this is all about.
Here is the San Francisco Bay. So here are the hills. Here are the mountains. Here are the valleys. plains, a river, the bay, and the peninsula.
Okay, so our Bay Area is pretty complicated, all those mountains. What geologists do is we look at these mountains and go, why? Why are they up there? Why is Mission Peak up there? Does it have something to do with ice? Or does it have something to do with things like plate tectonics where the earth is moving around? We're in a Bay Area where we'll see that the earth is really controlled by how our earth is moving, or what we call plate tectonics, that creates the rock cycle, as we will explore. Now, let's fly over the whole earth. Does the whole earth have different landforms than the Bay Area? Yes, some of them tell you a different story, and it's a geologist and yourself to figure out what it's all about. So let's take a flyover. So make believe you're in a really fast plane, and we're going over. We're starting in the Atlantic Ocean. That's South America to your left, and Africa as we go in there. Notice Northern Africa has a flat plain there, and then Saudi Arabia, that's flat too. Then we come over to India. India is flat, but as soon as you go up into Europe, the Eurasian continent, you get the high Himalayas. Is it high enough for ice? Yes. As we go into Europe, we're noticing it's kind of flat, but in certain areas it's not. Now you have to remember, the oceans don't have any water. So notice the landforms under there. Greenland, now we're coming to the United States, and we're noticing the East Coast, that's where Debbie is right now, and we're on the West Coast. Let's take a better look at the United States. Now, this is a relief map of the United States. So let's do a flyover here. We will start from, well, let's see, what side should we start at?
This is a map of the United States. Let's take a look at some of the features. In the west, you have a lot of mountains. This is the Rocky Mountains. Those are our highest range. Then as soon as you start going east, Kansas, Nebraska, you have the Great Plains, which is more flat. And then as we go to the east, you start seeing mountains, the Appalachian Mountains, and then you're out at the coast. You go from Maine down to Florida and in what we call the Gulf Coast.
Now notice there's all the blue. What does that blue represent? It is water. We have huge rivers because remember that water cycle, it rains all the time. Maybe not in California too much, but in many parts of the world, there's lots of rain. We cannot live without that fresh water. Now, if you notice over here, you see the words Mississippi, and you see a big river going down into Louisiana. That is the Mississippi River. And can you imagine a while back, maybe just 3 million years ago, here in the Bay Area, we had a big river like that, but not anymore because of changing Earth. So let's continue the story. Now, let's take a look at the rock cycle. Now, in a little bit, the kind of like the water cycle, it goes all around. It keeps continuing and continuing. A rock never dies, just like water never dies. It goes into a different form. And then as it is part of the rock cycle in this case, it keeps being changed through time. So our Earth is 4.5 billion years old. That's pretty old. And so through time, it has gotten larger, it's gotten smaller, and it's changed rocks through time. Now, we get real excited about igneous rocks when we see igneous rocks on other planets, because igneous rocks do, if you notice on the top there, what do? They produce volcanoes. Now, volcanoes do something very special. You see those big pillows coming out? Well, that is creating some of our original water, and we're still creating some water. But igneous rocks are, they had to have been melted at one time and then cooled down. Sedimentary have to be broken up and then cemented together. Metamorphic rocks, kind of think of Mother Nature as sitting on rocks and squishing them. And these rocks are changed through time. So if they get too hot, then they get melted, they would be considered igneous rocks. If they get broken, they would then be sedimentary. But what happens is the rocks go through time. So guys, I am going to entertain you a little bit by, let's see. I'm going to sing you a song called Ricky the Rapping Rock. Hey guys, are you ready for the song? You can sing along with me if you want. This is on our website and it is free. This is one of our most downloaded songs, Ricky the Rapping Rock. Yo, yo, my name is Ricky. I'm a rapping rock. I'm here to tell you how I got so hot. I was under great pressure till I reached the top. Folks call me magma, believe it or not. I was flowing down the hill when I felt the change. I began to get cool. That lava is my name. Outside I was exposed to air and moisture, and I cooled down fast. Magma cooled slow, so water could not pass. Then the storms came and broke me up of weathering and erosion, created rolling sediment. Here at a new place, I was all alone, till more sediment layered and compacted me to stone. Water moved in my spaces, cemented me together. Yo, my name is Sedimentary because of changes in the weather. Sedimentary can be sorted by the way they were formed. Plastic, chemical, or organic, group them as they are born. Igneous and sedimentary were my former name. Yo, change with heat and pressure, metamorphic, my fame. Yo, yo, my name is Ricky. I am changing all the time. Melt me, squish me, or break me down. Rocking and rolling from the top of the hill, I'm Ricky, the rock, rolling into town. Now, I'm going to go backwards on this song. I'm not going to sing anymore. I know I'm not the best singer, but you can sing on your own here. This was, as Debbie had said, was created by a high school student from Mission High. And we decided it was so cool that we animated it. So it's a way in which you can teach about set of the different types of rocks. Now notice here, Ricky is being cycled. This is the rock cycle. Igneous rock is the mother rock. So you have to have igneous rocks first. Then you have, notice I use the word erosion and breaking down. And that's how all these other rocks are formed. So let's go backwards for a second. And let me explain these. So here, notice, how's rock Ricky falling down? You see the rocks? What is pulling that rock down? Gravity. That's part of erosion. On our Earth, we have to deal with something called gravity. And so when a rock becomes unstable or a mountain, it starts falling down. Even if you become unstable, what happens? If you can't walk right, you fall down too. Gravity is pulling us down. And that is behind a lot of our erosion here. So Ricky just rolls around and starts eroding. So let's see, which one is this? Igneous and sedimentary were my former name. So that means they could have been igneous, they could have been sedimentary, but heat and pressure changed it to what? A metamorphic rock. Now, notice, for some of you, you might know who this character is supposed to be. It's Elvis Presley. And Elvis was noted to be a, what do they call him? A rock star. Rock. Why are they called a rock? Why is rock and roll? If you remember in the other picture, a rock can roll. And even songs were named by the changing flavor of songs. And that's how rock and roll got its name. But it, and also Elvis Presley used to wear sparkly things and things like diamonds and things like rhinestones and or the mica. They are formed by a metamorphic process. So it's very fitting that Elvis is a rock star. Now notice here, these are sedimentary. Now notice in here, we have some fossils where it says organic, that's a shell fossil. Now sedimentary rocks are the only ones that have shells in it. If you walk up to Mission Peak, you'll look down and you will see clam fossils. How did they get there? Did clams just walk up there and decide to die? No, they were down by the water and they have uplifted as plate tectonics. So this whole idea of how these rocks move around changed, and it's up on top of Mission Peak. Let's go back again. Now let's take a look here. Remember I said in sedimentary, rocks are broken down and then they're cemented together, usually by water. Water has to be involved in sedimentary rocks. Now, this is, now you notice here, when you have a river, the next time it rains, it's supposed to rain tomorrow or in the next few days. Watch how rain comes from like Mission on the peak, on the mountains and comes down. Gravity pushes it down. Now, as the water is coming down, it's eroding the rocks and the soil on the side. Now, remember soil is organic matter, which means living, plus rocks. And so as they get mixed, that is what helps us plant, but that's a whole nother story. But erosion and gravity is pulling that water down and it's going to erode our hillsides. Now, this is where it says when the storms come, and that's they're coming next week, they're breaking them up a bit and they'll be creating rolling sediment. Okay, and then we come to what was the mother rock type of rock? It is a very hard rock, and they cool down differently. The ones on the outside cool very fast. That's why if you notice here, the one on the right is fine grain, because rocks are made up of minerals, and they got little bitty minerals in there. And then the magma chamber, which is deeper inside of the earth, it cools slowly. And it makes big minerals. So there's a whole lot of stories we can tell about igneous rocks. But again, that's a whole nother story. Now here, notice the magma comes up and what is it called? Lava. So chemically, it's the same magma going up and the lava flowing down. So like in Hawaii, where the lava comes out, or Mount Etna in Italy, this is what the mother rock looks like. And then here we go again. So yo, yo, my name is Ricky. And he's rapping because he's all excited about these different types of rocks. Now let's look, now that you know a little bit about rocks, remember mother rock has to be melted, is called igneous. Ones that were broken down and cemented together, sedimentary. And those that have been changed by heat and pressure, metamorphic. Okay, I have to change back, guys. So Debbie, take off.
Okay. So one thing to remember, igneous, ig is the Latin word for fire. So if you can picture in your head, when I say an igneous rock, a firing rock, think of an exploding volcano. You've got magma deep in the earth, and those are all igneous rocks. Now, again, those fire rocks. So think of a fiery hot volcano. Then we have water rocks that are formed where the water puts it all together. The water smushes it together. So those are your water rocks. They're called sedimentary. And then you have metamorphic, which is meta's changed. It's either fire rocks or the water rocks that have been remelted or reformed. again through that rock cycle. So it just keeps moving all the way around. So it goes through the igneous, metamorphic, and water rocks. And depending on what kind of rock you have around you, changes your landscape and your landforms a lot. Now, my mountains that I live near, the Appalachians, those are very old, old mountains. So most of my rocks are metamorphic. They have been changed so many times. They've been melted and reformed.
So Debbie, do you see weathering?
Yep, we see weathering, rate of erosion.
Okay, great. Now guys, there's different rates of erosion. Some are very quick. Like if you look at the picture on the right-hand side, what is that? That is a landslide, and landslides can occur very quickly. Here in the Bay Area, even around, if you go up to Mission Peak and you look down, a lot of landslides have occurred over time. And so notice that it's taking the trees. Sometimes this occurs here in the Bay Area, it occurs when it rains a lot and the soil gets super saturated with water, lots of water in there. And it quickly comes down and creates some real large landslides. So those are quick over time. So that would also include volcanoes, earthquakes, floods, and the landslide. Now, slow over time is sedimentation. So look at the picture on the left-hand side. It shows how islands and can be formed when big rivers come down and drop their load, we call it, or sediments, and they slowly build up. This would be like in, remember I talked about the Mississippi River and going into the Gulf? That is slowly building up. Now, also, plate tectonics is slow. If you think about it, here in the Bay Area, we have some major faults like the Hayward Fault and the San Andreas Fault. Over the last 5 million years has moved land from the LA area up to here. And so it's slow, but it's sure. But in geology has time. So when we talk about this, we're gonna look at slow and quick. Now, so if you weren't quite sure what plate tectonics was all about, inside of our Earth, we have movement. And that movement causes, because of the different layers we have in our Earth, just because we kind of move around, we cause melted rock in what we call the asthenosphere. You can see them in both these pictures. And then what happens is the rocks then go kind of like in that cycle, like going back to Ricky. It moves around. Sometimes it gets trapped inside. Sometimes it comes back up. And this is all part of our rock cycle and the changing of our landforms. Now, going back to that plate tectonics, look at this picture here. If you notice the time where it says MA, so now it goes from zero time and then going back. So 35 million years ago, and look at how our Earth has changed. Now look, if you look at India just squished into the Himalaya, into creating the Himalayas. So this is kind of intriguing to a lot of geologists. We love to understand how these landforms are created over time. So this is slow and slowly through billions of years, and then we have the quick ones. Okay, so make sure you understand that part. Now, sometimes though, plate tectonics is fast. Now look at, that's a picture in the 1906 earthquake. What happened? Oh my goodness, it collapsed. All those buildings collapsed. Just within probably a minute of time, it becomes unstable and it can rock and roll. And guys, if you were here just a week ago, we felt an earthquake which was quite a ways from us, and I felt a shake at night. Now look over to the right. That's an animated GIF of what? A tsunami. So an earthquake that occurs in the water can create big energy waves. And as you can see, this water is coming into the land. So plate tectonics can have some quick, but those are rare. And sometimes you don't want to be near those. Slowly reoccur. You're feeling them all the time here in the Bay Area. Now, also, we have biological activity. Now, what's that little guy doing there? Burrowing? Does that create? Oh, you probably think, oh, that's nothing. They just go into the earth. But if enough animals can go and burrow and something heavy on top, it can collapse. Also, over time, and these are biological, tends to be slow. If you look at the tree there, the tree roots are coming up and it's breaking the cement. So even biological activity can cause landforms to change. Now let's look at more. Even a, what is that guy up in the top? That's a beaver. Now we used to have a lot of beavers here in the Bay Area, but we don't anymore. But they can create, what are they doing there? A dam, and the dam behind the water can cause some problems later on. It can go too fast and cause erosion in the river. And there is a little mole over there. Notice how he's burrowing. So biological activity can create slow changes over time, or slow to us. Okay, now we want to talk a little bit about temperature and pressure. Now you guys felt the great winds we had just the other day, and you probably goes, why did we have wind? Well, wind is caused when there's a difference of temperature, when the water is maybe too cold and the land is too hot. It creates different pressures over the land. So this place between the land and the water causes these large winds. Now here in the Bay Area, we call those winds Diablo winds. What the Diablo means is it's coming off of the Diablo range. So Mission Peak is part of the great mountains that we have here. And then when there's a difference in temperature, now I know you're not in the ocean, so you're not feeling it, but the temperature difference causes a pressure difference and then wind is created. Now look at the picture up on the top. Now that wind is created over a desert because there's no water involved. And so it can pick up the little sand particles. And do you think you want to be in there? No, and we'll show you some more pictures of that. Now look underneath there. Those are what? Those are our hurricane. Now what we felt the other day was we almost had low hurricane. We were going up to 40 to 50 miles per hour. That's pretty, pretty rough. Now you put water in it and the water is moving with it and it can create a substantial amount of erosion. Now also tornadoes are created too when the winds will go around and around and around and it causes damage just in that point. So wind, even though on a nice day, wind is nice, when that wind comes at you, it can create different erosional patterns. Lots and lots to think about, huh? Now, so here we are in Africa. If you look at the picture with the camel there, think about this, guys. You have heard of the Great Pyramids of Egypt. Can you imagine that they were covered because it used to be more wetter? Then what happens is it dried up in the northern part of Africa. If you see here in this picture here up in the top here of Africa, that area went from green to sand and it covered it. These used to be lush valleys. And so some of our ancient civilizations of from 5,000 years ago have changed because of the weather patterns change. Yes, that's called climate change. It does occur naturally. And then it can be accelerated also. If you look at the picture on the left, do we have deserts? Yes. Just think about in Southern California, they have something called the Santa Ana winds. Now, during this fire season, you heard of all those fires, and they were caused by when mountains are high. You can see the relief of the Santa Ana Mountains. Wind just comes down. And then if it's fire, it's very dry, then you get a lot of fires. So we call them firestorms sometimes. But without water, LA area would be a desert. A matter of fact, until humans came, it was a desert. And this whole area was wetted. We took water from the Colorado River. Imagine that, coming all the way from the Rocky Mountains. And we brought that water to the down in LA. And so now that's how people can live there. They also take some of our water from Northern California down to Southern California. That's a whole nother story though. But so landscapes are caused by dry winds. Now, these winds can look at that. This is what we call a venefact. You see that kind of weird sculpture? If you go down to the Mojave Desert or the Death Valley, these are our deserts here in California, you can see weird structures. Wind, as it keeps picking up little pieces of sand, it can then start sculpting and eroding the area. Now, if you look at that area and to the right end area, you can see all these windstorms creating erosion. You wouldn't want to get hit in that because it can make erosion on you. Now let's go into a sandstorm. Look, the car is going in. Doesn't look too bad. But then as you go into more of this, it gets like dark. And that is, you would be being hit by sand. This is not something, some people don't think how bad that is and that you have to, you don't go into a windstorm like that. You kind of stop your car and you wait, because this will cause major damage. But anyway, going back to the pyramids of Egypt in Africa, all those pyramids were covered by sand. And so they sometimes find new parts of the cities that were covered. And that is something that does happen. Now, let's talk a little bit about, what's that word, guys? Gravity. The big rock falls down. And no, rocks don't really have faces like that. But just think about that poor rock. Ah, I can't stand it anymore. I gotta fall down. Boom. Falls down. That's what we call a rock slide. Would you want to be underneath there? No. Rocks can cause major damage and it can bury you. Slowly though, gravity can cause something with glaciers. If you look over to the left, those glaciers that are coming down there, those glaciers are coming down and they're slowly cutting. We're going to see an animation of what happens there. But just remember, these become unstable and they will fall. Also rivers, and I discussed that earlier, where water is pulled by gravity. Now, let's look at this animation. There's a glacier on the top of it. It melts. As it melts, look at these valleys that they created. It has created this, what we call a U-shaped valley. So that's, geologists can tell if there were glaciers. They kind of like cut into the area. Very, very powerful glaciers, but very, very slow. And so when we see them, you will notice that they cut in. And one of the little activities we're going to suggest that you do is to make these U-shaped valleys, because you have to remember the water. A glacier is nothing but solid water, and it is erodes on the bottom, creating these U-shaped cuts into our Earth. And this is a map. If you look at it from the top, that's what it would look like. Now, the difference between that and a large river is that a river cuts and makes V-shaped valleys. So if you look at these pictures here, the picture on the left, you can see it looks like a V and not a U. Think about it, guys, when you go up to Mission Peak or you look into our areas, are they V or are they U? They are V. So most of our erosion, so we have one thing going on, plate tectonics is moving up the mountains, but the water is cutting it. And it cuts it what? As a U or a V? Cuts it as a V. So look at our V-shaped valleys just in the Fremont area. Now, Phoebe's going to show you just, I'm over here at Tule Ponds where she's going to show you what's happening with the water here.
Let's take erosion at this creek. So as you can see here, gravity is pulling the water down this way. And when the water hits a curve, it goes faster. So it cuts into the soil and creates a bend. So it's actually eroding away at the riverbank. You can see that erosion in the curve of the river.
So guys, that is, was that a U or a V? That is a V. A U would be much, much bigger. You have to remember, geologists, we use symbols that we can help remember us. But a water erosion is causing these little V-shaped valleys throughout Tule Ponds and throughout Fremont. Now, look at this picture here. What's happening? The waves are, oh my goodness! What are those waves doing? They're what we call undercutting. They're eroding. The waves, are they powerful? You've probably been to the ocean. Have you stood up and a wave comes? And what happens when you fall back? Because the wave has energy and it's pushing you back. And then gravity, when you become unstable, you fall down. Same thing happens. Along our coast, we have these kind of erosions occurring all the time. Would you want to build here? No. Because you will wind up in the water. So it is undercutting the area. Let's if you don't understand that, let's look at it a little quicker. Now notice guys, this is when how water undercuts. When there isn't much water too, it can slowly drip and drip. A drip can wear a mountain away. And if you notice underneath there, there's a cave. And so this will undercut. Eventually, the top will get heavy and what will happen? Gravity will pull it down. Now, you guys have heard of Santa Cruz, and there's a little city by called Capitola. Let's look at what's happening there. This is a drone flying over, and those cliffs look, I don't know, you can't walk up those cliffs. They're way too steep. They're almost at what we would call like 90 degrees. Now, what is going on there? Well, what's happening here is, again, the earth is moving up because of plate tectonics. As it goes up higher, what are the waves doing? The waves are undercutting in here. And then what will happen? In my lifetime, since I've been here in California, there used to be homes along the sides there. And what do you think happened to them? They wanted to look at the coast and get a beautiful view of the ocean, but they fell down. And they had to be evacuated. So there is problems when you don't think about the science of how our landforms are forming. So, okay, what's another thing that could occur? Now, this doesn't happen too much here in the Fremont area, but in an area like in Florida, where it has land underneath it that when water gets in there, it rains a lot. And what happens is it kind of erodes at it, almost kind of like those little animals eating at it. But these are, it gets dissolved. It's what we call a sinkhole. Now, so one day you might be getting up to go to your car and you find the car is where? In a sinkhole. And if you look at the picture to the left, you can see a huge sinkhole just start. So sometimes you don't even know that it's going to occur. And then because you're walking, you're driving, you don't think about it, but underneath it's slowly eroding and causing a, what I call it? A sinkhole. Now look at what we have here, guys. What is that? That's without the little rock with the face. This is how they kind of fall all at once. Do you think you'd want that rock to hit you? No. And what is causing this? Now, if you notice, the slope of the mountain there is kind of steep. And when it's steep like that, gravity's pulling everything down. So this is causing a massive rock slide. Now let's look at this one, a mudslide. This is before and after. Well, what is a mudslide? Well, a mud is the soil up on the top. If it rains too much, it becomes very wet. When it becomes wet, it will flow, and that's called a mudslide. Mudslides can be devastating in the, especially if you have a real rainy and there a big earthquake occurs, a big, and like I said, it's rainy, the rocks will come and be part of it and it can cover whole cities. And so it can be very, very fast. So these, all these things you have to think about, you have to think about what happens, how the earth reacts to where we build homes. Now, I don't think you would want to build a home next to a volcano. They have to think about this because when it erupts, what happens? The molten lava will come out and it will burn anything in its path. So you can't imagine anything that that could, you can't withstand it. So sometimes I kind of chuckle at some people that try to put barriers against the volcano. Can't happen. It will just burn right through. So these are volcanic activities causing landscapes to occur. And if you remember here, that if you have a volcano, it creates kind of mountains, but it can be also flat. But you can't, when it's erupting, you cannot get in its way. Now let's look at, what is this word? Pyroclastic. Pyro meaning fire and clastic. This is a classical, when you have a big eruptions like we had in the 80s, we had a huge eruption at Mount St. Helens, which is in the state of Washington. And what happened was it erupted. There was so much pressure inside the volcano, it blew its top. When it blew its top, it broke the different rocks into just fine, what we call pyroclastic flow. And it's little bits of the volcano, and then it goes up in the air. In Mount St. Helens, there was glaciers up there. Now what would happen? Now glaciers, remember, is ice. What would happen if the pyroclastic particles and molt and the melted glacier, it made a mudslide. Mudslide. It was 64 feet high, came down the area, and it just devastated any homes that were there. And so this is an example of like when volcanoes can do some severe damage. So when they tell you, when the scientists tell you not to go there, don't go there. Now, let's take a look at how you can experience and how you might do some of these activities at home. Here's Phoebe going to bring out some of our kind of clay. There's different, you can use clay, Play-Doh, shape it. There's a whole bunch of things. Or get this, guys, you can go outside and make a mud area where you can see how much water you can put in there to build it up. But let's see what Phoebe's going to do.
Let's make a model of erosion. This represents wind erosion. You can see how it can change the shape of the landscape. This represents water erosion. You can see it's cutting into the earth here. This represents glacial erosion.
So what she used there was she used a fork, a spoon, and a knife. Knife would be where the erosion is pretty hard. It really can do an erosive deal on the landform. So that's why she was using the knife for glacier. Then the spoon was smooth because when all that sand is hitting you and they're small, it kind of makes smooth surfaces. You can tell, or I can tell, when a rock is in a sandstorm because it gets smoothed. That's what we call a vent effect. And then the water is in between. So the water can use the fork to kind of cut down, but it is limited where the knife can cut this big U shape. Now, this is just different kinds of clays that you can use. Make sure that you probably either do it outside or you have something in there. Now, notice we have little marbles there. The marbles represented raindrops. So you can look, if you make a side of a mountain and you put, and that represents rain, and you put it down, the steeper it gets, the faster the rain will go. The faster the rain, the more erosion you go. So this is not a complicated, this is a complicated subject. Now that goes to your worksheets. I just wanted to spend a little time on those because you can learn a lot just by looking at our globes, our maps, our kind of like our relief maps like this. You can look on the internet. Google has something called Google Earth, and it can make it look like you're flying. So this is a way in which you can look to other countries and see what their landforms are. So let's take a look. Now remember, temperature influences landscapes. So the differences of temperature between land and water can create more severe weather, and that weather can create different landforms created by either that ice, wind, or water. So this is just trying to show you that usually the colder parts are found where? In the North and South Pole, but also in higher areas. So are there glaciers in the Himalayas? Yes. We are now, they always talk about climate change and the melting of our glaciers, and that is occurring right now. Now let's take a look at the worksheets. There's four worksheets. This one is a Southern Australian view. So where is Australia? This is a good way to learn about where other people are. Australia is down here, and globes are kind of neat because you can see more accurately the size of the land versus the water. So here you're looking here and you're going up to, notice in here, what is this? This is Eurasia. So this is really kind of one continent, Eurasian continent. You have India coming up in here. Now notice here that this is the only part of the world where you have land and water. Half of it is land in the Northern Hemisphere, and in the Southern Hemisphere, it's water. This is where our weather occurs because of that difference in temperature. And so along here, and this is kind of cool, like in India, you would have, so this is the same kind of picture here, where what I'm doing is coloring, the ice erosion is red, the water erosion is blue, and the brown is, has to be wind, and that would be brown, I mean brown erosion. Wind erosion is used brown. And so you might need to look at Google, but if you notice in here, and this is what I did this morning, I went on the internet and I said, deserts in Australia. And I found out that there's a desert here, and that desert has wind erosion, so I made it brown. And then if you look in India and all this areas here in Japan, they have a lot of water. They have something called cyclones. We have tornadoes, in, but a cyclone is even bigger than one of like our tornadoes. So it causes a lot of devastation. So take a look here and try to predict. You can almost predict that there's the red in the north and here, but here in the Himalayas, look over here, guys, there is actually glaciers in the Himalayas, especially in Pakistan and India. Okay, let's look at now. So look at this. So this is, you could either use the sheets and you could either color them or make a circle. So, and you have to remember there's erosion underneath the waters. And as you got it in there. So you can color them or you can make circles depending. But the thing to think about it, think about that temperature. Now this is Eurasia to India. So this is Eurasia. Now remember, this is huge, large. And we have the North Pole and we have Arctic. We have, actually there's water up here, but there's actually large ice in these areas, what we call sheet glaciers. They are starting to melt down though, and that's causing a lot of U-shaped valleys to occur. So if you look at here, you have red is what, guys? Red is ice erosion. And then here in Saudi Arabia and parts of Africa, you have wind erosion. And then the blue, you have lots of water erosion. Now, the other form here is, which one is this, guys? Africa, which is right here. So Africa, so we have Africa to Arctic. You have in the Saudi, the sub-Sahara Africa. This is just so many cool places that you can learn about. And then the last picture we have is North to South America. You have the Arctic, and then you have in South America, you have a big desert behind the Andes Mountains. And then we have water erosion. And then even we have a desert in our southern deserts.